Environmental entropathy. Environmental entropathy is a poorly defined syndrome characterized by structural and functional intestinal impairments with intestinal inflammation and barrier failure without necessarily overt diarrhea, occurring in individuals exposed over time to insanitary environments. The prolonged and persistent exposure to multiple enteropathogens is thought to be the main culprit, and this condition is fully reversible upon removing the environmental adversities. Traditionally, these histological features were identified in symptomatizing patients with chronic malabsorption from indigenous population and travelers to tropical areas and were thus called tropical sprue. The same histological findings were later also hosted in asymptomatic individuals in the same geographic areas and were termed tropical or environmental enteropathy, or more recently, environmental enteric dysfunction. Characterization of this disease has long been a dilemma because although environmental enteropathy in a strict sense is an asymptomatic change, there is considerable overlap with other enteropathies associated with more severe forms of malnutrition with or without persistent diarrhea. Consensus about case definition and pathognomonic lesion remains sparse. Nevertheless, it's a disease with a significant impact on child malnutrition and oral vaccine failure, especially in low-income countries. Although the specific mechanics of the disease is poorly understood and largely theoretical, there are some consistent findings backed up by evidence. At the heart of this disease is an overload of enteropathogens coupled by imbalance with deficient or immature microbiota. This culminates in intestinal damage with barrier failure, with ongoing attempts at healing and repair and simultaneous enteric as well as systemic inflammation, with the epigenetics playing an important role in modifying the final outcome of the disease. Of note, the intestinal damage can culminate in malnutrition, and malnutrition in return aggravates the intestinal damage. And this bidirectional relationship precipitates a vicious circle. On the other hand, immunological factors can precipitate yet another vicious circle of their own via the role of the relatively recently recognized regulatory cytokines. These T cell produced cytokines, with the help of other specialized T cells, produce tolerance to dietary antigens. Enteropathogens and environmental enteropathy can break this tolerance and establish a vicious circle in which the dietary antigens become the sensitizing agent maintaining the epithelial leakiness. This explains worsening of the disease and gut permeability with the correction of the nutritional status in some studies. There is also evidence that excessive T cell activation can generate autoantibodies and even celiac-like autoantibodies, and this autoreactivity in return aggravates the mucosal pathology. This is to highlight the considerable morphological and serological overlap between these entities, coupled with the practical difficulty to ascertain the primary inciting event, which led many authors to consider them to be present on a disease continuum rather than distinct entities. Regarding diagnosis, a lot of potential assays can be carried out on intestinal biopsies, with the routine light microscopy being the cornerstone approach. The main histological findings are the villus atrophy coupled by increased crypt depth with penetration of the Brunner glands into the mucosa, with enterocyte damage and reduction in secretory cells, with the lymphocytic infiltration inside the surface epithelium as well as the lamina propria with the formation of lymphoid aggregates. To sum it up, it's a crypt hyperplastic villus atrophy enteropathy with Th1-like inflammation characterized by increased CD25 positive and intraepithelial lymphocytes. This is seen in many diseases characterized by mucosal T cell activation, such as celiac disease. To highlight the main differences with celiac disease, environmental enteropathy have generally less severe or moderate form of villus atrophy with more lymphoid aggregate formation. However, in severe forms such as children with HIV, environmental enteropathy can show celiac-like total villus atrophy with increased CD3 positive intraepithelial lymphocytes and even celiac-like autoantibodies. Luckily, these antibodies are present on the high normal end spectrum rather than elevated level seen in celiac disease. The differentiation between both entities can be helped by a model of deep machine learning fed with digital images of both entities. A scoring system was recently devised using 8 histological criteria to confidently differentiate between both entities. Out of these, goblet and panel cell depletion appear to be a prominent feature of environmental enteropathy. This can be further highlighted by immunohistochemistry showing a decrease in human defensin 5 expression, a peptide that is produced exclusively by panel cells. Immunohistochemistry is also superior to routine H&E histology in correlation with nutritional status, as worsening of the nutritional status produces consistent changes by immunohistochemistry. A better quantification for multiple antigen can be achieved by Western blotting and multiplexed immunostaining. Electron microscopy is of limited value. A scanning microscope provides a view of the surface villus changes in a way analogous to dissecting microscopes, while transmission microscopes generate a high magnification cut section in which some antigens may be illustrated. Some important pathogens may be illustrated. Thank you.